how you research.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I had you one to yesterday about ideal scope.
Mm-hmm.
You are going to look at associates, units, Euclidean domains. As we teach this strategy, you should start thinking of whether you can dwell in one of those areas to look at something which will help you as you write your dissertations. Congenital. I think that's the intention, because so that you are not just writing exams, you are also going to pick something which will develop further for your research in dissertations. I will still utilize this note, lecture notes, which was which I also inherited from my teacher, from M.S. Audu, on rings, on these ones before. Later on, if I exhaust it, I'll look at some supplement which I will write myself. Because I consider the material to be good for beginners like you in these areas. I'm sure you are treating these areas for the first time. So as though it's better you go through definitions, basic conception, before you go further into researches on any of those areas. So we did a lemma last time, which we proved. We're going to look now at some remarks, some motivation for what we call co-sharings. So we have some motivation. We do not then R by K, where R is a ring, K is a sub-ring. Okay. So we'll start with say, let K be an ideal. Sorry, K is an ideal. Let K be an ideal of a ring R. So we say let K be an ideal of the ring R. I think yesterday we saw what ideal means. The last time we met, we saw what ideal was, a special sub-ring with some special properties in comparison with the ring itself. So it's ideal with all the attendant properties, RA, RK, or KR is an R, and AB is an K, any A in K. So let K be an ideal. So you now have a ring R and you pick K as an ideal proper. Remember, ideal is also a subring, so like a subset of ring. Okay. Now let R by K be the set of all elements X plus K. It's X in R, okay, with S in R. What of K? K in K, okay? So you are now picking set of all pairs, X plus K. These are actually, what do we call these? Cosets, okay? We call them cosets of X in K, right? Because K being the subring of R and X is an element of the ring. X is already element. So this is a collection of cosets of K and R will now be denoted as R by K. This is the definition of the quotient ring, R by K. Then we have the definition. Then we have the definitions, okay? like this. Number one, x plus k plus y plus k equal to x plus y plus k. This is it. And minus x plus k is actually minus x plus k. And again, that's number two. Number three, we have x plus k into y plus k is actually xy plus k. Then this implies that rk is a ring. This will imply that r by k is a ring. This definition implies that r by k is already a ring. Why is it a ring? Well, it satisfies the two properties of addition and subtraction, as it is closed and there is associative and multiplication. Yes. Remember, look at it. X plus k plus y plus x plus y plus k. That's because you know k plus k is just k. Multiples of k's are only k, just k. So if we just say x plus y plus k, should have been x plus y plus k plus k, but k plus k is just replication of k, which is the same k. But minus x plus k is actually minus x plus k, because minus k is k, because k is an ideal, and ideal is subring. So, and x plus k into y plus k is simply x1 plus k. Why? Because x times k, x into k is just k itself. Isn't it? So it's a collection of k k's. If you have k plus k plus k, it will just give you one k. So you only have x, y here. But this definition means that r by k is a ring, because it is closed and it has a negative, the inverse is already there. As this has two requirements for. But with this definition, you can develop the identity. You can establish the associativity across people. If you add one more, z plus k, it will be x, y, z, and so on and so forth. You can use associative law. Remember, since the x and y and z are elements of rings, so they associate naturally. Yes. So this is a ring. You may be asked to establish that r by k under this definition is a k. Are you going to use these definitions to establish that?
Yes.
That's remark number one. Number two. The margin. Remark number two, or let's say, I will call this A. Motivation A, motivation number two. The margin. Okay, this one is not too good. The margin defined by this I, which maps S to X plus K, which maps S to X plus K, okay? That is, it must, this margin now, that this implies that this margin of pi is actually a margin what? K to what? R. This margin R to R by K. This margin is an epimorphism. Is an epimorphism. Why is it an epimorphism? You may have to verify this. Verify that this margin, under these definitions, forms an epimorphism. That means onto. It means it covers R by K. That's what you do. So if you want to verify this, all you need to do is to show that, remember, K is fixed, isn't it? Remember, if you want to prove this, it's very simple. You remember that, well, by definition, X in R by K, R by K O. R by K by definition is simply X plus K, isn't it? X in R, which means K is what? It means K is fixed, it's just like picking cosets. It's like the one you have X H, Y H is something, so you keep H fixed and you buy what? X is, remember? So it means this one only by with binding X. And X, what are X's? X's are elements of power. You are real, isn't it? So that means that this is like that. Every X plus K in R by K is an image of some X in R, isn't it? And the number you're having is from R to R by K, isn't it? Is it clear?
Yes, that means every theta imperfection also this also alternatively
every phi inverse, okay, of what? Of X plus K. Every phi inverse of class is actually a member of R, is actually an element in R. Every phi inverse which you pick from here is actually from some objects in R, and in your ring, remember. So this is so your proof that what is complete. Okay? It's complete. That the matter is an epimorphism, because that's the definition of epimorphism. That's the definition of epimorphism, that's the matter which is on, which covers the whole range. That is, the whole range is covered, yes. There is no element in the range which is not an image of some object in the domain. That's the meaning of an epimorphism. Yes. So, I think that's the second motivation for us. And I think the third one really verifies that there is a one-to-one and order preserving correspondence between the ideal M of which and then of K and the ideals M dash of RK given by M dash is equal to M phi. So that means you can always have a one-to-one order preserving correspondence. Meaning that just like in R, just like in the ring R, you may have a corresponding ideal K, or I guess ideal, okay? K and ideal of R. Likewise, in R by K, there is some ideal, we call it M dash, where M dash an ideal of R by K. Then another curious mind may wish to know what's the relationship between what K and M dash. In other words, you may wish to know more. What is it? Are they related? This is an ideal. This is an ideal. This ideal of ring. This is ideal of kosher ring. What do I say? What did I have to write? Kosher ring. Oh, M is the ideal of kosher ring. K is the ideal of ring. What is the relationship? Are they related or are they totally different? I said common sense. Common sense will tell you that they should be related. Because after all, the R by K is obtained from R, isn't it? the co-sharing will not exist if there were no rain in the first place, isn't it? So you expect the idealist actually to be related. In fact, they are. There is one-to-one correspondence between the ideals K of R and then the ideal R by K of what? Of K. Okay? So that means if you write this, for example, if you say the ideal in ring is in your ring, your ideal is K. In your R by K, your ideal is F plus K, isn't it? Yes. You can clearly see that it's all trans correspondent, isn't it? After all, S is an element of R. And K is an ideal of
R.
Exactly, yes. So you can always build, you can try to, I mean, start to put a mark in K from X from R by K now. I will let me say from to K. Okay. From R by K to K. So which is 1 to 1. And also ordered residing actually for all elements there in this. So you can decide that at least one of the mapping. You can investigate this one. What is the property of this one? As it turns out, it looks like a constant map, which maps all x k's to just k for any x. So it's like projection, isn't it? All s k's now. Theta of x plus k is simply what? K. For any what? For any x. So this is a projection. This is what we call it, projection. But you can pick small k also, and a small k, k1, k, but in the case are also in k. Yeah, they will give you only that small k. Yes. But normally what we do in courses, we don't pick element, we pick the whole subset. Big k, the big R. Yes. Okay, lemma. We have a lemma here, lemma. This lemma says, let R be a commutative ring. Let R be a commutative ring. Okay. With identity. Okay. Okay. Then R is a field if and only if its only ideals are zero ideal. Then R is a field if and only if its only ideals the zero ideal and R itself. Zero
ideal and R itself.
Okay. That is, R has no profile, because that's this mean that is R, if only if R has no proper ideals. Because the zero ideal and R are what you call improper ideals, trivial ideals. Zero is trivially an ideal. And R is already an ideal because it's already it's ringed and it should be closed and such. So these are like trivially known. That way, if R has no non-trivial or non-proper ideals, then it is a field. Provided that it is commutative and it has identity. So these are the two things you need to add to R.
Okay.
A ring first, then requires your ring to be commuted. Not all rings are commuted, of course. Of course, all rings are commuted. With respect to multiplication, we call them commutative rings. They are special rings, which are also commutative with respect to times. But ordinarily, all rings are commutative with respect to addition plus. Remember, your rings has two binary operations. It has the plus and the times, isn't it? Now you call your ring commutative if it is commutative with respect to multiplication. And not all rings have identity elements. Rings are not supposed to have identity elements. If you have a special ring which has an identity element 1, then you say you have a ring with identity. Ring with element. But ordinarily, all rings are supposed to have identity element with respect to plus. And that is a 0. Every ring has a 0. But not all rings will have 1. Is it clear? If your ring has 1, is a special ring. You say you have a ring with identity. For example, you may wish to consider in your research a special ring with something like not one, but something like I, which sometimes behaves like one, sometimes behaves otherwise. And if you do that, you say you have discovered a special ring, which has something close to one, but not actually one. But and so on. Under certain condition, it looks like what?
Under certain conditions, it looks like
something like. So you may design that as you go on to research. But other rings are actually standard rings. Rings, identity, commutative. They are standard in the literature. Now, if such rings also are discovered to have no proper ideals, then such rings are called fields. So we have a proof with this. We want to prove that if your ring with this property has no properties, a field. So we go this way. Firstly, let R have no property. So suppose R has no properties. Okay. Supposing it has no properties, then what we are going to show is that it is a field. Because it's an if and only if proof. Then you now suppose again that supposing it has properties, then you prove that it is not a field. Then if you do that, you have proved both ways. So we are going to prove like this, if like that R has no proper ideas, therefore it should be. Then we come back later to prove other harvest.
Then what is the implication? What does it mean if we know if we say R has no
proper ideal? Okay.
Then we must show that R is ideal. Now it suffices to show that for A not equal to zero. Now if it suffices to show that for A not equal to zero, if you can element A not equal to zero in R, okay, then exists B in R, then exists on B also in R, such that P is also not equal to zero, but AB is. This is set of all XA with X in R. Okay? It is easy to verify that RA is an ideal. It is easy to verify that RK is an ideal. Set of all XKs is X and A. Remember, A itself is an element of R. Yes, so it is easy to verify that this is actually an ideal. By our assumption on R, we see that now by our assumption, on R, we see that, okay, there exists RA, we see that RA is zero, okay, we see that RA is simply what do you assume of R? We assume R has no
profile.
Isn't it? Yes. So that means this is an ideal. By definition, it must be zero. Or what? Or R itself. Isn't it? Yes. So this must be either zero or
R itself.
Or R itself. Since A is not zero, then this must be zero. What happens? If this is zero, what does that mean? R is not zero. It means A is zero. Isn't it? Yes. So that means A must be zero. So that means we have to show for A not equal. That means A must be zero. That means it means. Okay, so by our assumption we see that OR is RA is qualified. So the second one like that is right is OR A wants to be what? It's either RA is zero or RA is R. Good. Now so as one belongs to R, we have there that there exists B in R such that B is equal to. So as one is an element of ring, because we remember here we say R commutative ring with identity, that means R has an identity. So there exists an element one in R. So therefore we now say that there exists B in R such that. So that means this implies that there exists some B in R such that AB is 1. AB is 1.
or DA, whatever. Remember, you are really commutative, isn't it?
Yeah, so this is also equal to BA, but this one,
because your array is
commutative. That means here, is, since one is here, there must be R plus one, that means one times A is zero, or one times A is one, so it's like
one of the two will happen. Then in that case, we have the other exists being as such as a table. So, this is, if you look carefully, what is this? This is, this shows that, this shows clearly what? If AB is 1, it means what? It implies that A is equal to the inverse, isn't it? Yes, so that means in this ring we have a ring passed which is commutative, which has identity, and in which we have now found out every non-zero, element A is non-zero,
A is not zero,
isn't it? Has a multiplicative inverse B, which if you add them you get to, and this is the definition of, and so this implies that every non-zero element such as A now, which is not zero, has a multiplicative inverse. Okay, say B. Now that means AB is 1. And this is the definition of ring. This is the definition of what? Of fields. This is how you define field. Fields are rings which are commutative and which are additive, and in which every non-zero element has one. So we have actually constructed a definition for fields from this assumption that A has no non-proper, no proper ideals. Because we see that either RA is zero or RA is R. Okay? Of course, A is not zero, so RA will not fix this. We are going to fix this as is. So we now, what we do in this, we say we pick B here in R. We say B, we pick some elements here, B in R. We say B times A is equal to, we pick one element, one. Now B is an element of R. 1 is also an element of R, arrive at that. So that is one way. Then we now go the other way. That means only if. Is it clear? This is only if. So we call it compass. We say compassly. So we have done with if. We are now trying to do only. How was the compass go? How was the second part? Okay. Compassly, let R be a field. Then we try to show what? Compassly, let R be a field. Then what do we want to show? We have to show what? That R has no proper ideals. Yes. So we want to show we are to show that R has no proper. Meaning that only identities are only zero and the one. There's no other. Okay, so how do we go about this? Maybe we have to kill in this side. Sure.
That's a good practice. What is it? And the lens is the an ideal of R. Okay. Let A be an ideal of R. Okay. Now we pick two things. We pick a field, supposing R is a field score, and supposing A is an ideal of R.
Okay. We are ideal of R. And suppose that A is equal to 0. And suppose again A has only the element 0. That ideal is only the element 0. Okay? Then what is the implication of that? It's what we are trying to show. So then there exists A not equal to 0,
okay,
and A, okay, and of course since it is in A, it's also in R, okay, so it's also in R because R is the bigger set, okay. So there is this A in A, but let us require it to be in A first because we are interested in this ideal now. Because we want to, this is the ideal we want to test, not in the case. Supposing this is in equal to now, but remember, R is a field, isn't it? And A is just a subset of the field. So since R is a field, there exists, since we say A is not zero, A number should be, isn't it? Yes. Good. So what does this mean? It means, therefore, that now as A is an ideal, we have that A inverse A is in A. So, but A is an ideal. So, A inverse A is also in A because that by definition. By definition of A, of ideals, they are closed, isn't it? Under multiplication. So A inverse A should be actually inside the A. And there are two. And the R equal is also in A. If you pick any element, that means and what? And R A should also be in what? A. For some R in, that definition of ideals, isn't it? Yes. So, what's the implication of this? And that is what is in A. So that what the implication is A inverse A. That's what this implies. One is an element that means A has one. Okay. Now, if I don't contest one, what does that mean? So for any R you pick, this implies that for any R I pick in R, it means what? R A will be what? R times one, which is just R. Isn't it? So pick any elements in R, multiply it. What is it? Okay, did I say times one? Okay, James, in the cross.
So any name, it means therefore, this implies that since you say for any arrow, that means so R1, and R will be R1 times 1, which is R1, R2 will be R2, RC. So all the R's will be here. Isn't it? So RA is going to encapsulate all the R's. So that means the whole R will not be contained. By the time you exhaust all the R's. So it means therefore, yes. Good. So the whole R is actually inside it. Yes, and you know, by our assumption, A is already inside what? R. Is it because A is an ideal? Let A be an ideal of R, isn't it? So by our assumption, we know by also by our what do I call by we call it hypothesis by hypothesis of this theorem, we know that A is already contained in what? So this implies what? R is A.
They are the same. Yes. Yes. Yes, that is so. What does that mean?
If R is A, what does that mean? That means you assume R is a field. Isn't it? And you assume A is an ideal of R. And suppose I is equal to 0. And then you now have shown that A is actually R. Isn't it? That means the only ideals A and R are either the 0 all the work are there, is nothing in between. So we say complete in the group. Yes. So we have the. So you can see how now we have arrived at the definition of fields through lemma, a theorem on ideals. That means these structures are somewhat like I took in the beginning, they are interrelated. You can build one from the other. All you need to do is to build special cases of one. Because it's not all the ideals are like this. Some ideals are proper ideals, but those ideals will not give you fields. The proper ideal, you collect all the proper ideals of R, they will give you something else, but not a field. It means from this concept, if you are doing some research, you can categorize R into two partitions. Maybe if this is your R, you can partition it into two partitions. You can say these are proper ideals. These are improper ideals. And you have already obtained that the proper ideals will be what? The improper ideas will be has no proper ideas though. Those with the improper ideas is one you have. This one will give you fields. Oh? Now you now check what you have. What collections are you going to have? The other sides of the partition. Your first partitions will give you fields. All those ones in the which are not proper ideals are categorized into fields. What of those which have
in which you have proper ideas. What will it give you? You may decide to think and come up with things. So that is actually what we have. We have definition now. Let I be an integral domain. Maybe I will read this, since you are going to have the lecture, not later. Let I be an integral domain. Then number one, if A be I have, then A is set to divide B, simply A by B. I'll let you write this definition. Okay, definition. Let R be an integral number one. If A and B are in R, then A is said to divide B. Written A slash B like this. Not divide by A slash A divides. Okay. If there exists C in R, if there exists in R such that B remains. Or C B C, I say. Let me write it like this, that it was C. That means A, C, C, okay? That means B, C. Let me write it like this is better, so that you're not confused. The divide by with this. Okay, yes. Okay, that is number one. Number two. A unit in R is an element which divides one, okay? Which divides if
So we now write in symbol, we write like this, we say as associate. Okay. Something like this, okay? Or one line is at least it's an associate for Y. If X divides Y and Y divides X. Okay, if X divides Y and the Y divides X. Compliance and associates and equivalence relationships implies associates defines equivalence relations. This is one question we need to ask. Try to establish whether associates as an association defines an equivalent relation or elements of R. So these definitions are, I think, very handy. You'll find them useful in the subsequent discussions as we go for more discussion on fields. The first one, you pick two elements of R and say one divides the other. Literally like this A by B, if there exists C such that B is equal to A. Okay? Meaning that, like I tried to write for you in the first place, that way if you now say A divides B, this means that if you put A and divide it by A, you get some C. That's B of A divides B. Okay? Not A over B, it's B over A. Okay. So that's one. Second, unit in R is an element which divides one. Any element which divides one is a unit in R. That is, pick any two elements XY. If XY is equal to 1, then Y is equal to X inverse. It's a unit. Meaning that uniquely defined by Y. So each one element, Y for example is uniquely defined by X, X is uniquely defined by Y, and the two are actually one, isn't it? It means therefore that X is simply one over
Y.
That means so that means XY, which means XY is equal to 1. Okay? That's the main reason. So that's the meaning of this. And then associates. Two elements are associated. One divides X divides Y, and Y also divides
X.
If they are like this, each one divides the other. That means X over Y, some C. And also Y over X is also some D. Okay, where D and C are elements, then we say they are associates. You may wish to do this and this should be a good homework for you. You try to establish that this last one is an equivalence relation. Okay. That means what? You try to show that it is, let's say, transitive and selective. Okay? Try to show that it is symmetric. Try to show that it is what? Transitive. I think one is straightforward. If X over Y is from C, you normally say the first one is automatic. This one, you say X by X is what, and Y is an element of R. So X divides X. X divides.
this is reflexive. It's very easy to show.
Oh,
and the biases.
Thank you.
Now, error number two, x, if x divide y, it means what?
Y
by x is some c. That means what? It means what? Cx. This implies what? Cx is equal to what?
Y.
Is it? That means by x by y. Oh. So Cx is equal to y is from Cx or some c in R. But by definition of associates, by definition, you are also told that y divides x, isn't it? Meaning that, meaning what? This implies what? X over y. Some D since for some D in R. That means YD is also equal to X. Then, so simply this is actually transition. This is symmetric. The definition gives you symmetric.
Because it says x divides y, y also divides x.
So symmetry is clear. Transitivity, you say x divides y, meaning that y is equal to some z. And supposing y divides from z, meaning what? Is equal to what? Is equal to some. Z is equal to some what?
Maybe D
Y. Then you can say, can we say X divides Z?
Yeah.
Because what it means is that Z is also equal to what? Some maybe E X. But remember what is your x? From here z is equal to dy, isn't it? Yes, and
y is cx. And y is cx.
Y is cx, exactly, yes. So y, you substitute y here, it means what? You substitute for your d
cx.
You substitute here, isn't it? And then so therefore, it's the same z. So that means dc. So this is simply meaning that dc is e. Because it's a half element of R. So this is simply dc. So your d is simply dc. So it's actually
x.
So it's clear. That it is also transitive. So this is actually an equivalence
relation.
Okay. Good. Now, what?
Symmetry.
I think symmetry is part of this. You are talking about this?
Yes, z equals to dy.
Z is equal to dy, yes. But y from here is cx. Yes. So it's dcx. Yes.
How did you get that?
No, any element in R, just multiples. Okay. They are just numbers, multiples. Okay? Maybe 2, we may say 2 is 2, d is 2, c is 1. So what we only mean is that this z is a multiple of x. Because this d This is what you would see, so distance is also multiplied to a number. Okay. So that's a remark. That's when you can read this. Then, evidently, every non-zero element in a field is a unit. I say you can check this also if you like. I guess the motivation for anybody to be this. Then the following
can be verified. And it may be a good homework for you if you try to verify the number one. Number one says the units in Arab, okay, what's the unit? The units in R form a multiplicative abelian group. I say you have no problem verifying this. Number two. Also from this integral domain, you can also verify that two elements x and y and r are associates. Two elements x and y in R are associates. Okay.
If and only if
x is equal to u y, or y is equal to u inverse x, for some units u. Number three, if S is an indeterminate over R, then the units in the form, then the units in the polynomial ring Rx are close enough. Number four. Clear the units in Z, the ring of integers, and the units. In Z, the ring of integers. Any element x and z are plus or minus x. Okay? And so the associates of any x. I think you can take your time to be able to come up if you try to verify this one by one. Number in bracket, ring of integers.
Number three.
X is an indeterminate over R. Then the units in the polynomial ring Rx are just in R. It will be good homework for you if you try to. You probably can verify it one by one. For example, what does number one mean? Let R be an integral domain. The units in R form a multiplicative group. What does that mean? You remember the definition of UNESCO? Any element which divides
one. Every element which divides one.
Then?
X, Y,
and
equals to Y.
Not so quickly, but. Of course, also it's a form of multiplicative abelian group. Yes, it's true. That's requiring X, Y. Yes. So, what's the consequence of it means what?
That if you pick any element X in the integral domain, you remember integral domain is also a ring with identity commutative with identity which there is no non-zero divisorship. Integral domain says there is no
non-zero divisors.
Yes, that mean
which mean
zero divisors are what? Which has no zero divisors.
Zero divisors, I mean what zero divisors mean, we have x, y equal to zero, where x is not zero, y is not zero.
We don't have this if you have this situation we say that this set has a zero divisor, okay?
Okay, let's explain this. Let us explain one side.
I want to give you some hint, but maybe not. I don't want to solve everything any time. Maybe you'll
I'll give you some hint to solve them.
You try and go and solve like this. Okay. But
I will start with zero divisor. Zero divisor, you know what it means. That if you have x, y in R, x not equal to zero, y not equal to zero, but x, y is zero. Do you have situations like this?
By integral times them.
We have situations like this. Now one would say we have like in Zn this one will happen, maybe Z4 or this. Maybe Z6, which is 1, 2, 3, 5. This is Z6. Okay. Suppose X is 3, Y is 2. Okay, you know they are not 0, it's not 0. But you know X, Y is 2 times 3, which is 0. Therefore, it's in our 0 divided score. So you may have situations like this, we call them 0 divided. Integral domain, so that's about integral domain. But what about what we are saying that the units form multiplicative? Unit by definition, unit means if you pick any x in R, by definition, it means what? There exists what? Some y also in what? R such that X, Y is equal to 1. That's the definition of units. Cool? We say that this means, this implies that X is equal to Y members. You need to define it. Just like you can also say you can say Y is equal to X members. Now what's the implication? If you have a situation where each time you pick an element, you have an inverse. I think that's a group theoretic property. Isn't it? That means you pick
For example, then if you then this implies what? X times X is simply what? X times Y inverse. Because X is Y inverse. Okay? For what? For X, Y in alpha. Isn't it? Oh? Yes. So this is, and this is the definition of group. This group is subgroup. Subgroup means group. And so it's simply a group actually. That's why, meanwhile, XY is already in R because XY is nothing but what? What is XY?
One.
And one is in R because R is a unitary. So this is the definition. You have shown that it is a group. To show that it's abelian, you know that if XY is one, it means simply that YX is also one. YX will also be what? 1. So that means XY is equal to YX is equal to 1. Meaning that this is abelian. So your group is also abelian. And so on and so forth. What is the time?
Are you well? I've moved to two issues.
So maybe we stop here today. As we try to do this. Just making this one. You verify that as yourself.